Mental health. I know we've been reading everyday news about parents. They want their kids, to go back to school, right? Because so many kids staying at home for so long is not normal. That's what it is, right? All of our mental health is kind of taking a toll, right? Because of COVID. So that's what we want to talk about today, is how Ayurveda can help. With me, joining me is Dr. Sujata Reddy. So just hang on for 1 second when I get her in. Just for 1 second. So Dr. is an Ayurvedic counselor. She's an Ayurvedic doctor. Hi there, Dr. Sujata. How are you?
I'm doing well, Amita. Thank you.
Sure. So I was just telling our viewers that, mental health has definitely a subject that is being surfacing so much, specifically during COVID times. And, you read in the news, parents are, campaigning, oh, we want our kids to go back to school, and teenagers are locked up. All of us are locked up at home. So Ayurveda can help. And here we have Dr. Sujata Reddy. She is a mental health counselor. She's an Ayurvedic doctor. She's been practicing mental health for the last many, many years. So maybe just tell us about a little bit about yourself and we go into the topic after that.
Thank you, Amita. I'm Dr. Sujata Reddy. I was first trained as an Ayurvedic doctor from India. I'm a BA MS, Ayurvedic doctor practicing in the United States. And I have a private practice here in the state of Colorado. And I'm also a licensed professional mental health counselor. So I have expertise in the Eastern and Western aspects of how to go about, not just, of course, as a licensed practitioner, I do focus on mental health, but as an Ayurvedic doctor, I do also focus on physical health too. Yeah.
Okay. So you're practicing both, right? The Ayurveda
yes.
practice as well as the counseling, the traditional counseling, what we are, what we're used to as a psychologist or a mental health counselor. Yes. So let's just say, how do you combine the two, right? Because Ayurveda has a lot of tools to help with the mental health as well. So how do you combine?
Mental health has really evolved. It is not like it used to be before. It is a very subjective field, and there is always a lot of changes going on into how to incorporate and how to give the best to our mental health issues to our patients. And so there is always changes happening in the field of psychology and psychiatry in the United States. A lot of the times, they have adopted the Eastern techniques like mindfulness and breathing techniques that have been incorporated in the mainstream practice of counseling. And, nootropics and Ayurvedic herbal supplements and some other natural, supplements are also incorporated, although there is a scope of practice, the limitations with what we want to do and what we should not be doing. And that keeps changing always. They give it different names. My specialty in that respect is cognitive behavioral therapy, acceptance and mindfulness based. I'm also certified to treat mental health with nutrients, vitamins and herbal supplements.
Okay. All right. So let's just, this is not an education session for all the viewers. This is just to give you an overview or just give you a tools, that you can do a little bit self-care by yourself. So having said that, what are the simple things that you would recommend on a framework of that uses, you just said nutrients, some vitamins, nutraceuticals, right? And then you're talking about some Ayurveda. So what are the tools that we should use?
It all depends. It's such a broad spectrum. Each individual is, somewhere in that whole spectrum. There is aspects that the psych meds play a part, that we cannot ignore. If it is very psychotic, where mental health, again, is a very broad spectrum. And as much as going through daily stresses, in a mild way to a magnified way. And you just mentioned that, due to COVID, we all are kind of feeling very suffocated and very stressed. And we are all like, constantly, we have no outlet for anything that we used to do before. our body actually finds that very threatening, you know, finds that very dangerous, and it kind of goes out of balance. You know, we are experiencing stress because we don't have the freedom. You know, one thing that we have to exercise is free will as a human being, and that has been taken away in many aspects, and we are not able to do what we were doing. So looking at our body in Ayurveda is always adjusting to the external environment. You know, we call it homeostasis. You know, the doshas that get imbalanced during these times, as you know, with COVID or any other stresses from the external outside environment to our body is a threat. So our body is trying to always balance, you know, whether it is we go into a vata imbalance or a pitta imbalance or a kapha imbalance, depending on the constitution and the chronicity of the problem. You know, so when we are looking at that, there are various things that we have to understand and educate ourselves first. You know, hey, what is it going on? Why am I feeling anxious? Or why am I so depressed? I am so frustrated. You know, when we have these questions, you know, I don't have the freedom. I don't have the space. I cannot go to a restaurant. I cannot go freely anywhere. You know, this is all, you know, your body is feeling trapped. When your body is feeling trapped, then that is recognized as a threat. We all are born with a certain amount of bandwidth, you know, with how much we can handle stress, how much we can, you know, adjust, and you know how much our body can work. It depends on our emotional immunity, our mental immunity, our physical immunity. You know, it affects us in that. And once we expire that immunity, you know, then we start to feel imbalance. And that's the part that we really need to be educated on. Okay, what can we do? You know, this is what going again, you know, implicitly and looking at, you know, what my body is feeling, where am I feeling this? You know, right from there on, what helps? You know, if my nervous system is so sensitized, I'm having a vata imbalance here. What is going to happen? What do I need to do? I need to ground myself. I need to do certain techniques that I follow the Ayurvedic daily routine, you know, about the grounding techniques, and do some yoga, do some pranayama, you know, and mantra chanting. All that will keep us sort of balanced. And if it is a little more, that's not enough, then, you know, we have to biologically assist our nervous system, you know, take some herbal supplements, you know, or vitamins. Like the vitamin B's are very important. Omega-3s are very important for our nervous system. And then, you know, herbs like ashwagandha, brahmi, you know, these are the classic Ayurvedic herbs that are researched, can be found, you know, we can find research papers in PubMed and, you know, all the other medical journals that, you know, we can use. But one caution is, do not doctor yourself. You know, you have to reach out to a professional, and you have to, you know, take their expertise in taking care of yourself. And we have to support ourselves in all different levels. You know, as we all know that we are not just what we see as us. You know, we are five layers. The panchakoshas is what, you know, we call. We have to take care of ourselves in all the five levels. You know, one is the physical level, you know, so then comes the vital functional level, then the mental level, then the emotional level, then the spiritual level. So we are all interconnected, you know, from the micro to the macro. So a lot of this comes from how becoming aware of how we need to take care of us in all these five levels. You know, we call them Annamaya Kosha, you know, Pranamaya Kosha, Manomaya Kosha, Vijnanamaya Kosha, and Anandamaya Kosha. You know, these are the things that we can, even though the terminologies are Sanskrit and to the Western world, you know, all these can be foreign. Hey, we can actually bring that to their awareness in the vocabulary that they would understand, and they would, you know, be able to adopt these things. And, you know, sometimes we have to be very careful, you know, say, oh my gosh, you know, this is some, you know, we have people in different spectrums. A lot of people are completely oblivious about the Eastern techniques. So we have to give them the scientific evidence. We have to give them user terms like mindfulness, you know, like how it has been scientifically researched about how it's going to help us with our anxiety, our depression, and, you know, our stress levels.
That's a lot of information, Dr. I think amazing, all the information that you're giving. So a lot of people, so I just want to summarize it a little bit for the viewers. So I think Ayurveda and yoga has amazing tools. I think all of us know mindfulness, right? And the daily routine of Ayurveda, you talked about that. You know, daily routine requires, I mean, not requires, but it suggests, I should say that, daily Ayurvedic practice, yoga practice, and a certain ritual that Ayurveda has. When you wake up in the morning, you massage yourself, right? Correct me if I'm wrong.
We have to see, you know, our sense organs first. You know, skin is the largest sense organ, you know, and the nervous system in the skin, you know, is just exuberant. And so what we have to do is start addressing ourselves from that biological, you know, sensory skin, you know, that we can apply oils and we can massage. So what that does is it sends messages to the brain, right? There is that touch, there is that feel, there is that becoming, you know, grounded and being in tune with yourself. And a lot of the oils, some of, you know, are, again, you know, medicated oils are wonderful, like ashwagandha bala oil, you know, these are the things. And coconut oil, it again depends on the season and depends upon, you know, how intense your situation is. Ayurveda offers not just external body work, you know, we have the oil massages, daily oil massages, then we have, you know, what's called as shirodhara, you know, that the oils are poured here. That, of course, we can't do that every day, you know, that we have to literally go to a Ayurvedic massage bodywork person, you know, to get all those things done, and it can be very expensive. What can we do at home, right? Very simple. As soon as you get out of the shower, you know, you just apply, you know, you do have moisturizing lotions, but instead of that, you know, that use a touch of lavender into the oils, so that way you can, you know, the smell is good, and lavender is also very relaxing. So, you know, just apply it on your skin, and that actually will relax you, you know, and for the rest of the day, when you practice pranayama and mindfulness, you put out a good intention for the day, and you start from there, you know, so you're basically observing what is happening outside, and not actually taking it too personal, you know, so that's very important for you to become the observer of the observed, you know, it's very important that we do that, so we can feel that, okay, we are only observing what's happening outside. And, you know, this is how we have to now change. You know, it's not going to be our techniques have to change, you know, to support us in how to manage our own mental health.
No, I think that makes sense. I mean, a daily massage of yourself, you know, with any oil that you talked about, and skin being the, you know, biggest exposure, right, of our bodies, and helps to calm ourselves. I mean, that is something so simple that each one of us can do, along with the yoga. You talked about that, and some pranayama, and then
Right? And, you know, when we look at how it affects, right, you know, we release when we do all these massages and when we do all this touch, right? Hey, that feels that, you know, it releases oxytocin in your body, you know, and the release of oxytocin, the dopamine and the serotonin levels and the endorphin levels, you know, are so important for us to feel good. You know, when we feel depleted in that, again, you know, we start experiencing all these imbalances.
So just to, for a self-care, so someone is asking a question on what yoga poses are good for mental health. Do you want to name a couple of them? Just something?
Mm-hmm. So yoga does not mean just postures, right? So we know that, you know, there's Ashtanga yogas, right? Like the eight branches of yoga. So just for the sake of posture, you know, very grounding, you know, laying down type of yogas, that is Sarvangasana, you know, just the thing is, you can do yoga nidra, you know, the yoga nidra itself, you know, start with Surya Namaskars in the morning, you know, nothing can beat that. When you start with Surya Namaskar, if you're not used to it, just start with 7, 14, 21, you know, these are the sets that you can start doing Surya Namaskara. Then you go on to the pranayama breathing techniques, right? And then you go on to the meditation, the mindfulness techniques. By the end of it, you know, what you're doing is activating your parasympathetic nervous system, and, you know, you're not in your sympathetic overdrive. Now you're going to start at a very base, you know, like very calm place. And then as the day goes along, you know, your stresses can go up, but the only way you can come back to the baseline is become mindfully aware of how you breathe. Take a few deep breaths on the hour, you know, just get out of the original routine and do something very different, you know, on the hour, like get up and stretch and, you know, just take deep breaths, go drink some water, you know, and then come back to your desk, you know, give yourself on the hour about 5 minutes break to 10 minutes break to whatever you're doing. That can actually, you know, bring down a lot of stress levels. You know, we're not steaming like a pressure cooker otherwise.
Yeah. No, I think these are good. I mean, you know, just to give all of you a self-care in the morning, sun salutations, I think everyone knows now. Surya Namaskar. That's a huge, amazing, amazing sequence. It's a sequence of different yoga poses that you know, you can take it at your own pace, like Dr. Reddy's talking about. And then pranayama is simple breathing, right? Alternating
Yes.
Nostril breathing is pretty good,
Yeah.
right?
So one more thing, you have to be very mindful about, say, you have high anxiety levels and you're too traumatized. You know, there are certain pranayamas you cannot do. You know, the one thing that I would say universally you can do is the alternate nostril breathing. Take, like, first start with the, you know, few deep breaths, you know, the expand your belly breathing, and then, you know, just go into the you know, alternate nostril breathing. You know, that kind of aligns your the energies in your body and really balances the Ida and Pingala is what we call along the spine. And so, you know, that also in the Chinese medicine, it is called yin and yang. So, you know, we can definitely balance those energies. So it's all about when we are facing stresses, you know, whether it's biologically or whether it's from the outside, you know, it's all about how much we want to do and get back to our balance. So that's what counts.
Correct,
and, you know,
correct.
There are more, you know, things that we can do with prayers or mantra chanting, you know, mm-hmm. or a certain, you know, diet, you know, if what are we eating, we have to also see, you know, that is going to escalate our already existing, you know, stresses. You know, are we eating too much sugar? Just to make, are we, you know, getting into a different habits? You know, we call it prajnaparada, whether it's more alcohol or more, you know, imbalanced foods or incompatible foods. You know, we tend to, you know, do this to make ourselves feel good. There's nothing, the intention is good, is to, you know, make us feel good. But how? Now, how? In the long term, how is that going to impact our nervous system or our body? You know, is that healthy for us in the long run? A little bit, you know, is okay. But then when and how is very, very much, we need to pay attention to that. Yes.
Okay. Someone's commenting again on mantra chanting. Which mantras? Well, we can tell. I think there's,
you know,
so many.
It depends
mantras.
On, see, mantra does not mean just the Hindu ritual mantras. Okay. A mantra is a sound that you can chant that makes you aligned. You have to feel aligned. Just like we have different TV channels and different radio channels, right? That we kind of tune to whichever that we like to hear, that whichever we are going to be energized with, right? So, you know, say if you are not from a Hindu background or not from a Vedic system, you know, if you are having another religious background, or, you know, if you're not even religious, if you're, you know, spiritual, or if you're an atheist, so whatever you relate to, you know, it's just about sound therapy, you know. So those are the things that you have to figure what is the right one for you. You know, of course, if you're coming from a Hindu background, it's just a simple Om is fine. You know, just chanting Om is fine. There is also Gayatri mantra. There is Mrityunjaya mantra. You know, these are the mantras that are very powerful that you can actually chant, you know. And then whether if you're a Christian or a Jewish, you know, I'm pretty sure, you know, there is different sounds that, you know, you have that you can say and bring that, you know, adopt that, you know, every day. It does, because yoga, the breathing and all, is nothing to do with religion. It has to do with bringing homeostasis to your mind and body.
Absolutely. And, you know, the sound healing has also a lot of research, as you're talking about, like Tibetan bowls and what they call is sound bats, right? All the Tibetan bowl sounds and different sounds have different vibrations. So Om chanting Om, to your point, you know, there's a lot of research on chanting Om that you can find on PubMed. It has all the research on chanting Oms. It has research on the massage that Dr. Reddy is talking about, on Shirodhara, you know, the dripping. It's like a dripping oil on your forehead. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of research on all these techniques.
Yeah, and another bodywork is also Nasya, you know, the oils. Just if you're having anxiety or, you know, stress, you know, when you're in bed, you know, all I would suggest is, you know, just put a few drops of sesame oil or coconut oil or ghee, you know, in your nostrils, and that really goes a long way. It is a direct, you know, transportation route to the brain and the,
correct,
you know, members of the layers of the, you know, the brain, and it definitely helps with good sleep, good practicing, you know, hygiene. Sleep hygiene is very important. And so yoga nidra, I mean, that's it takes you to a very deep subconscious relaxation state. And YouTube has plenty of them, you know, that if you want to just type in yoga nidra, follow, you know, and then there you go. You know, you are anytime, you know, that can be okay. used as long as you want.
Sure. And someone's asking which oil is good to use. You talked about, I think, I forget, the coconut oil, which with the lavender in it.
So the question is, you know, for adults or, you know, you mean for the nasal drops? I would say in the winter season, you know, absolutely go with sesame oil.
Sesame oil?
Okay. Yes. Yes. Okay. And that is very good for even children. Now, children, you know, it's very difficult to administer nasya and all that. So, you know, just body massage, you know, I'd recommend is just give them a good massage before bath, you know, put them in the bathtub, you know, let them play in the water a little bit. They're happy. They go into that very relaxed state and then, you know, give them a bath. And I would say keep them in the oil and, you know, for about 15 to 20 minutes. That's good enough. And they will sleep like, you know, very relaxed.
Yes.
And even for us to have good sleep, and if we are not very, if our mind is running, you know, and we do not want to engage ourselves in anything external stimulation that will lower our melatonin, you know, to before we go to bed. And so, giving ourselves a bath and applying the oil, rubbing our, the soles of our feet with sesame oil, you know, and wear socks if you need to. And that really helps with good sleep.
A lot of tips, Dr. Reddy. I think this has been amazing session to all the viewers. I hope you can start sleeping better, start feeling less anxious, and start feeling a little bit more relaxed, right? You've got so many tips today. To summarize, you know, Dr. Reddy talked about sun salutations. She talked about Shirodhara. She talked about Nasya. It's like dripping your, you're putting your oil in your nose. Then she talked about Pranayama, alternate nostril breathing. And then you talked about some of the ashwagandha, right, for stress relief. Mm-hmm. So many different things. So much amazing information. Anything else you'd like to add before we wrap up today? Someone commented, very good information. I think amazing session, Dr. Reddy.
All I would say is towards the end of the day, we have to survive. Our body is built to survive. And it does by trying to adjust to the external environment, you know. So if, by following the daily routine and being in the rhythm of nature, the seasonal routines, the cleansing processes, you know, cleansing our mental toxins and our physical toxins are very important. I would say, you know, in your area, get hold of a good Ayurvedic doctor or a practitioner. If you want to know what your constitution is, how to balance your own body, because it's not one size fits all in Ayurveda. So we are all unique individuals. So that's what I would recommend.
Well, thank you so much. I think the intention is these sessions are simple self-care sessions, but if you're feeling more anxious and, you know, depressed or something, then seek out a practitioner. You know, we're not trying to advocate here, become Dr. Google. We're not trying to replace that. We definitely seek out practitioners. So thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Reddy. Thank you everyone for supporting us on every single day. Help us support more by sharing our sessions. We are bringing natural lifestyle to all of you. Thank you. And signing off now, this is Amita from Nourish Talk.
Thank you, Amita, for having me.
Bye-bye.
Bye.